Hello, this is Tom Belote with the Community Church of Chapel Hill Unitarian Universalist. I'm in the sanctuary on a Tuesday afternoon, re-recording my sermon from Sunday. There was a malfunction on Sunday, and so I'm re-giving it for video. Earlier this month, I started my session. This session of the preaching practicum, the people in this church who will be giving sermons over the summer. And I recall that one of the first lessons I teach to those in the preaching practicum class is a lesson that I want to share with you. And that lesson is that while a sermon may seem like a monologue with only one person speaking, a sermon is actually a conversation. It's a conversation between pulpit and pew. It's a conversation that happens within our own hearts as we speak and listen. And it's a conversation that begins and that's had between us going forth. This would be an easier sermon to give. Follow me here. This would be an easier sermon to give if all I had to do was call out the toxic behavior, the harmful behavior of people I don't particularly care for. It would be an easier sermon to give if all I had to talk about were the dozens of people sexually assaulted and sexually harassed by the President of the United States, the dozens of women. It would be an easier sermon to give if all I had to do was talk about how White House officials covered for White House Staff Secretary Rob Porter, despite being aware of his extensive history of domestic violence. This would be an easier sermon to give if I only had to talk about some of the people in the news this past week, like Republican Governor of Missouri, Eric Greitens, who currently stands accused of sexual assault, in addition to being charged with felony blackmail, or Republican Congressman Blake Farenthold, who finally resigned this past week, months after it was revealed that he spent $84,000 in taxpayer money to settle sexual harassment claims against him. But it is not easier, because within the last month, Democratic Congresswoman Elizabeth Esty of Connecticut also came under fire after it was reported that she kept a staffer on her payroll for 3 months after he was accused of physically assaulting and sexually harassing a female coworker. It is not easier because Democratic Senator Al Franken resigned earlier this year after his history of sexual harassment and misconduct was brought to light. This would be an easier sermon to give if Bill O'Reilly and Roger Ailes of Fox News were the only ones in the media to abuse power and abuse women. But it is not easier because it's also Matt Lauer and Garrison Keillor and Harvey Weinstein and Louis C.K., among so many others. This would be an easier sermon to preach if sexual harassment and gender discrimination were only present in, say, those Silicon Valley tech companies way over there. But it's not easier, because sexism is also present in the institutions that I care deeply about. As Reverend Susan Frederick Gray, the president of our Unitarian Universalist Association, writes, quote, "It is tempting to want to believe that sexual harassment and assault do not happen within our own faith tradition, among or our leaders, or within congregations. But this belief is naive and false. Just as we're being asked to confront the culture of white supremacy within and beyond Unitarian Universalism, we also have much work to do to understand the ways that patriarchy and sexism operate in society and in ourselves. In all these forms of oppression, we see the ways that dominant forms of power, consciously and unconsciously, can discount, distort, and even seek to destroy those who speak truth in the face of abusive power. my female-identified and gender-nonconforming ministerial colleagues, to say nothing of religious educators, other professionals, to say nothing of lay leaders and congregants, have attested to their experience that the patterns in our larger society do not cease as if by magic the moment we cross the threshold and come through the doors of the church. What is without comes also within. Sexism, patriarchal behavior, harassment, these do harm to individuals and contribute to structural inequality. The female-identified ministers I know speak of a stained glass ceiling. So despite the fact that women constitute well over 50% of UU ministers, in fact have constituted over 50% of UU ministers for more than 20 years, if you look at the 10 largest churches, men are the senior ministers of 8 of them, a male-female clergy couple serves as co-ministers of the 9th, and a woman is the senior minister of only one of the 10 largest brick-and-mortar churches in our denomination, the 10th largest. In past elections for president of the Unitarian Universalist Association, a man ran against a woman in 1985, and the man won. A man ran against a woman in 1993, and the man won. A man ran against a woman in 2001, and the man won. And a man ran against a woman in 2009, and the man won. And finally, most recently, in 2017, the presidential search committee put forward an all-female slate of candidates, and a woman won. What I'm not saying, please don't get me wrong, what I am not saying is that any of those male UUA presidents were bad choices, or that any of my male colleagues serving large churches are bad ministers. What I am saying is that when you have outcomes in which men over and over again move into the most powerful, most coveted, and highest paying positions, you can be sure that structural sexism and patriarchy are at work. Let me just say how insidious this sexism is. The current Unitarian Universalist Association president is the Reverend Susan Frederick Gray. I went to divinity school with her. I think extremely highly of her leadership. Now, being the UUA president, one of the requirements is spending a lot of time on the road. It is a job with an unrelenting travel schedule. And Reverend Frederick Gray, besides being an excellent minister, is also a mother with a school-aged child. And I will tell you, I was aware that as the election approached last summer, I was aware of muffled whispering taking place off in the corners, wondering whether she really wanted a job that would have her away from her family so much. As if this question would ever be asked of a man. This question was certainly not asked of the men with children who ran for UUA president before. As if the question to question a man's ambition would ever be asked. 6 months ago, just 6 months ago, exactly 6 months ago, on the 15th of October, 2017, the Me Too movement took off. Now, in reality, the Me Too movement is more than a decade old. Back in 2006, Tarana Burke coined the term Me Too when she called on women to go public with their stories of sexual assault and harassment. There were two problems, though. First, social media was still in its infancy in 2006. And second, Tarana Burke is African American. And the movement pretty much only reached the African American community. People outside of it pretty much ignored it. To our own detriment, right? Just imagine all the ways in which our world would be better if we had been aware of, paid attention to, followed the leadership of Tarana Burke in 2006, right? It was exactly 6 months ago that actress and activist Alyssa Milano sent out a message. Quote, "If all the women who have been sexually harassed or assaulted wrote Me Too, we might give people a sense of the magnitude of the problem." And the dam broke. "Among the female-identified people I know, my colleagues, my friends, my acquaintances, there was a massive outpouring of people saying Me Too and sharing their stories. I'll tell you that I don't think that there is a single woman in my social circles, in the circles of which I'm a part of, not a single woman without a Me Too story to share." Then, last winter, last November and December and January, I noticed that many of the female-identified UU ministers I know did worship services about Me Too, but almost none of my male-identified colleagues did. And then, in January, February, March, April, I noticed something else. I noticed that my male-identified colleagues began to preach sermons about masculinity. When I told a group of colleagues that I was planning to preach a sermon on toxic masculinity, a female minister friend wrote to me and said, "Whoa, that's a service I could never do." I wrote back, "Well, it's a service I can do, because I sure can't do a Me Too service." She wrote back and said, "Yes, funny how that works." So this morning, I want to talk about masculinity. I want to talk about two ways in which masculinity is performed. One of those ways is what is called toxic masculinity. The other way is what we might call healthy masculinity. Toxic masculinity is a term that is used widely and is becoming widely embraced in society at large, as well as in gender studies and some parts of the psychology profession. And toxic masculinity refers to ways of expressing one's gender as a man in ways that are arrogant, entitled, domineering, and lead to the attempt to dominate others. Toxic masculinity is linked to violence, especially violence against women, against LGBTQ people, and often against people of color. According to the website Teaching Tolerance, toxic masculinity is, quote, "a narrow and repressive description of manhood, designating manhood as defined by violence, sex, status, and aggression. It's the cultural ideal of manliness, where strength is everything while emotions are a weakness, where sex and brutality are yardsticks by which men are measured, while supposedly feminine traits, which can range from emotional vulnerability to simply not being hypersexual, are the means by which your status as a man can be taken away." In the aftermath of the Parkland shooting, Michael Ian Black penned an op-ed in the New York Times entitled, "The Boys Are Not Right." In it, he wrote, "I used to have this one-liner, that if you want to emasculate a guy friend, when you're at a restaurant, ask him everything he's going to order, and then when the waiter comes, order for him. It's funny, because it shouldn't be so easy to rob a man of his masculinity, but it is." Michael Ian Black continues, "Too many boys are trapped in the same suffocated, outdated model of masculinity where manhood is measured in strength, where there's no way to be vulnerable without being emasculated, where manliness is about having power over others. They are trapped, and they don't even have the language to talk about how they feel about being trapped, because the language that exists to discuss the full range of human emotion is still viewed as sensitive and feminine." Let me tell you, this form of gendered expression causes harm. Of course, it causes harm to women and to anyone who's dominated by men who express gender in this way. but it also causes self-harm to the man who expresses gender in this way. At its most extreme, toxic masculinity renders men capable of expressing only two states, rage and withdrawal, which is the absence or stuffing of emotion. I liken it to an artist with only two colors on his palette, red and gray. And thus we see high rates of depression and social dysfunction related to toxic masculinity. High rates of depression and social dysfunction like loneliness, isolation, the avoidance of intimacy, and other emotional pathologies. We might contrast that with healthy ways of expressing masculinity, ways that embody emotional awareness, vulnerability, the constructive exercise of strength, kindness, and other traits. In the week leading up to this service, I had a discussion with about a dozen church members over lunch earlier this week, but I also received emails from a number of people in the church sharing their thoughts. And what was interesting was that a number of the men writing to me wrote in support of traits that they linked positively to healthy masculinity. I'm going to share with you a list that one church member sent to me about the traits that he thinks are evidence of healthy masculinity. Here's what he put on the list. Purposefulness, independence, self-confidence, self-reliance, and self-discipline, adventurousness and assertiveness, determination and endurance, leadership skills, courage, loyalty, persistence, decisiveness, inventiveness, ambition, dependability, the ability to provide, and a worldly view. Now, it's interesting, it was this list that actually generated the most feedback after the first service, and people were having conversations about which items were on the list that they agreed with, which that they disagreed with, and others wondered whether these positive traits should be gendered at all. They wondered whether traits like nurturing, helpful, compassionate, tender, whether those might be universal positive traits, not merely feminine traits. And indeed, I think that there's something to that. I think that these traits don't necessarily have to be gendered, but that their expression, the expression of these good traits, is what makes for healthy living. But I believe it is important. It is important that we name toxic masculinity in the same way that it's important that we name white supremacy. First and foremost, because we are being asked to do so. But also because it's important to think systematically. Dominant culture asks us to see the world in individualistic terms, where the world is made up of distinct individuals, each separate from the systems of the world. There's this idea that by using a phrase toxic masculinity, that means that says that every single man is toxic, but that's not what the term means. That term means that there are systems, cultural systems, that are toxic. I think of the phrase, not all men, in the same way that I think of the phrase, I'm not racist, or racism is not my fault, I never owned slaves. Those sayings are evidence of fragility. Nobody ever said all men, just as nobody ever said racism is your fault because you own slaves. Those sayings are evidence of fragility, but they also point to a larger social context. It is true that we have all inherited a world that we did not choose. None of us said, this is the world that I wish I had inherited. But it's the world that I did, and it's our responsibility to try to do our part to make the world better than it was when we received it. And if we can add responsibility to one of those positive masculine traits, we would understand this. Tim Wise uses an example that I love, a metaphor that I love, and it at least for me is a gendered metaphor. I want anyone to think of a time when they might have had a roommate. Anyone who's ever had a roommate knows that dirty dishes left in the sink, food left to spoil in the fridge, the garbage that doesn't get taken out in time will start to stink. And you know that even if you say, "I didn't make that mess, it wasn't me," that you still have to smell, still have to live with the unholy stench emanating from your kitchen. Maybe you didn't make the mess, but you sure as heck are living in it. Earlier this week, I had lunch with a dozen members of our church to discuss the topic of masculinity within the context of this cultural moment we find ourselves in. I asked the women in the group to speak first about their own experiences. The women in the room wanted the men to hear several things. First, they wanted men to be able to comprehend how absolutely pervasive gender discrimination and sexual harassment and gross behavior is. Several women in our church emailed me with their stories of harassment in the course of their everyday lives, and I don't feel it's my right to share the details of what they told me. Suffice it to say that they described being harassed, stalked, and more in just about every setting you can imagine, and many you could not. One woman at our lunch meeting spoke of traveling for business at a time when it was relatively rare for women to do so. And she said that in order to avoid unwanted attention, she literally ran from her car to her hotel room, drew the shades and turned off the lights, and still she got men knocking on her door, wondering if she might want company. The women at the lunch who spoke of their experience of sexism as a constant diminishing of their education, their intelligence, their abilities, their competencies, as well as their wholeness, their worth, and their dignity as people. The women who spoke talked about struggling with the cultural expectation that they should always be at the beck and call of men, and that this cultural conditioning comes out even when they are trying to advocate for better treatment. Thus, the struggle to say, "Please don't treat me this way," at the same time as they feel a need to provide emotional maintenance to the person who they're asking to change. Let me say this again. Thus, the struggle to say, "Please don't treat me this way," at the same time as they feel the pressure to provide emotional maintenance to the person who they're asking to change. The men at the lunch gathering shared stories as well. Stories of the ways good and bad and mixed that they were taught to be masculine. This lesson mostly came from fathers, but also from culture, from peers on the playground, from education, from sports, from military service, and from the workplace. Male-identified members of our church describe the need to sift through those lessons, to take what is good while discarding the bad, the need to unlearn ways of being and then relearn better ways of being. And some spoke of the challenges of reacting to trauma, to develop a healthy masculinity in the aftermath of trauma, because the masculinity that had been developed was developed in order to try to protect them from trauma. And finally, both the men and the women challenged me to do more than just describe pathological expressions of gender, but to propose solutions. The women spoke to other women about the need to keep speaking out, to practice right speech, but to keep speaking out in ever bolder ways. And men expressed a sense that it was the responsibility of men to work on other men. And this working on other men, we tend to imagine it. We tend to imagine this confronting other men as a calling out. I know as a man, in one of my fantasies is that I will be out in public some way and see some gender discrimination going on, and that I will kind of rise to the occasion and with courage and with adventurousness sort of confront the situation and call out bad behavior when I see it. But by working on other men, that doesn't just mean calling out. That doesn't mean just intervening. It means actually a calling in as well, an active. Calling out is reactive, but calling in is active. It calls other men into this work. I have recently been part of an accountability group with a group of my colleagues. Our name for ourselves is White Fellas Working It Out Amongst Ourselves, and it's an accountability group around racial justice and holding ourselves accountable to being good and active and reliable partners in this work. We have an accountability group because it's not the job of people of color to make us better. It's our job to work it out amongst ourselves. And I wonder whether such an accountability group among men might be a good idea. At a more basic level, there's education and awareness to be done. I became aware a little while ago that I've got about 1,000 books in my office, and that 900 of them are written by men, and that 900 of them are written by white people. I sometimes wonder about what it would be like to change that, and so I actually began a little while ago a project where I said that for each book by a white person that I read, I'm going to try to read one book by a person of color to try to balance this out. And I think that that is even more important to do, or just as important to do with gender. And I wonder what it would be like to, for each book that I read from a male point of view, if I also read a book from a female point of view. I think about what's called the Bechdel test. How many of you have heard of the Bechdel test, named for graphic novelist and comic strip writer Alison Bechdel? The Bechdel test refers to a movie or a TV show or a work of art in which there are two women, in which the two women talk to each other, have a conversation with each other, and in which the two women have a conversation with each other that is not about a man. And it's surprising how few pieces of media actually pass that Bechdel test. In conclusion, may we leave today hearing those lessons, those liberating lessons that that religious liberals have taught us through the ages. That the old ways are not fixed in stone. That we can find authentic and loving and life-giving ways of being human together. That we might fashion in our lives, that we might fashion our lives in such a way that we abet the breaking forth of life. Go forth in boldness and humility. Go forth in courage and faith. Go forth to listen and